Good evening, and welcome to our Sunday night service for October the 23rd. Just some real quick announcements. Don't forget about your opportunities for giving to our weekly needs offering, to the audiovisual fund, to the food pantry, and to the Operation Christmas Child efforts. All of these things are causes that we are raising money for and giving offerings toward during this time period. Thank everybody that helped with the Margaret Lackey State Mission offering. This week on the 27th, our young at heart are going to the Jinx Sorghum Farm. You're leaving at 9:15. Bring a picnic lunch for the trip and bring some money so that you can buy some sorghum if you choose to. Our Young at Heart Harvest fundraiser luncheon will be Sunday, November the 20th at 11 o'clock. And our United Prayer emphasis this week is Houston First Baptist Church, as you see listed there on the screen. Let's pause for a word of prayer. Lord, be with us tonight as we study your word. Lord, let the things that are said and done, the prayers that are said, the words that are sung, the words that are spoken, touch our hearts, Lord, and teach us to live close to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Our call to worship tonight is I Will Sing the Wondrous Story. I hope all the hymns tonight are the right hymns, since apparently I did not get one of the hymns right this morning, and I do apologize.
Holy, holy, holy. Revelation chapter 13, God versus the false prophet. And this is in verses 11 through 18. God versus the false prophet.
Some of the characters from this period during the tribulation and the great tribulation and the battle that has not only been taking place in the heavenlies, but also the battle that begins to take place on earth with all the different things that are going on and taking place in Revelation chapter 13 on the earth. We see that the focus has shifted from heaven to earth. It will be bad. There will be horrible things that the world will be experiencing. And we'll see that it is coming from the false prophet that we'll talk about tonight, coming from the Antichrist and coming from Satan himself as the battle begins to rage between these three anti or false people of the Trinity versus God. We're talking about God the Son, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit is the Holy Trinity. And then we see here over the past 3 weeks now, we have been looking at the unholy Trinity, the counterfeit Trinity. And the false prophet will be much like John the Baptist was, and that he will go and he will spread propaganda. John the Baptist, we know, spread the truth. We know he pointed people to Christ. Well, the false prophet will spread propaganda. He will spread lies. He will spread untruth, pointing people toward the Antichrist, and eventually will prompt people and will coerce people and will basically force those who choose to take the mark of the beast into worshiping the Antichrist and giving him the honor and glory that was meant for God. Let's start out reading verses 11 and 12 of Revelation chapter 13. The Bible says, "And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him, and causes the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed." Let's pray. Lord, we come to you now. We pray once again that you would just honor the reading and preaching of your word here tonight, dear Lord. We pray that you will speak to our hearts through your word, Lord, that we will take your word and we will listen to your word tonight, dear Lord, and we will study what it says. We will think about, meditate upon what it says, dear Lord, and allow your Holy Spirit to reveal to us what we need to grow, what we need to be challenged, what we need to make an impact for you and evangelizing the world. And Lord, we pray all this now in Jesus' name. Amen. We see here that, and we've talked about this as I've been going through these chapters and these verses, all of this should prompt us as Christians to remember the Great Commission that the Gideon speaker talked about this morning, and how we've all been challenged, we've all been commissioned, and we've all been equipped with the ability to share the gospel, with the ability to spread the gospel. And we talked about this morning how we as the church and the Gideons partner together to spread the gospel through placing the testaments and the Bibles that they place in different areas, so that people can read the word, so they can be exposed to the word, so that the Holy Spirit can work and move. And we heard testimonies of how God had used those testaments or those Bibles in different areas to make a difference and an impact and completely transform people's lives. And we as Christians are to be sharing the gospel and allowing the Holy Spirit to work and to move, praying that the Holy Spirit will work and move and that He will impact people's lives, and we will see people being transformed by the Word of God. And what we know is happening on earth during this great tribulation period is that Satan has been cast out of heaven, and now he is wreaking havoc on earth. The Antichrist rises to power from these 10 European nations that become under his power and authority. It is a picture of the old Roman Empire, and you could really look at the Antichrist as a Caesar, much like Nero was, whenever we begin to think about some of the devastation and destruction and mistreatment that will be taking place during that time. And then we notice here in verses 11 and 12 the mission of the false prophet. He comes in with the appearance of a lamb, and it says that he comes up out of the earth. You'll notice that the Antichrist comes out of the sea, and from studying out biblical prophecy and all the things that go along with this, that leads us to believe that the Antichrist is a Gentile. Now, whenever you read in verse 11 and you see, "I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth," that leads us to believe from other places in Scripture and how people from the Jewish race are described in Scripture, that the false prophet will be from Jewish lineage. So we have a Jew who is now going out, and he is pointing people to worshiping the Antichrist, who is a Gentile. We see how Satan twists things and he perverts things, and how he also tries to imitate God and things that God had already put into place. There's nothing original about Satan and his schemes or his plans. He just takes things that God has already created, and he puts his twist or his spin on those things. And we see here it says that he had two horns like a lamb. It wasn't that the false prophet is going to come on the scene and he's immediately going to begin to blast the message out there and immediately going to cause people to have to bow down and worship the false, the Antichrist. And he's not immediately going to put into place the idea that they have to take the mark of the beast in order to do all of the things that they will be able to do as far as trading or buying things or whatever. He's going to come in and he's going to speak and he is going to be gentle. And as a matter of fact, he probably won't even be anybody that you would have thought could have been the false prophet. He would have not exhibited anything up to this point that would have led people to believe that he would speak as a dragon and that he would begin to proclaim the message of the Antichrist. He has the appearance of a lamb with the voice of a dragon, and he forces the world eventually to worship the Antichrist. He tells them that they have to worship the Antichrist, that they must worship the Antichrist. And by the way, as we kind of dealt with last week in the first part of Revelation chapter 13, in those first 10 verses, they're really not going to have their arms twisted to worship the Antichrist, because they've already kind of allowed themselves to be deceived. They've allowed themselves, as most of the world, to have the wool pulled over their eyes, and they think that because the Antichrist had that fatal wound and was resurrected in front of them, because we talked about it'll be a worldwide audience with satellite TV and Facebook Live and YouTube Live and all the different streaming things that we can do live now. It will be seen. It will be easily, readily broadcast, and it will take place in front of a worldwide audience, and so people will already be falling over themselves, basically, to worship the Antichrist. And so the false prophet really won't have to twist their arms much. He'll just speak, and people will begin to bow down. People will begin to worship. People will begin to praise the Antichrist because of the promises that he had made to the Jews and the promises he makes to the world. They think that he is the one that is going to bring peace. They think that he is the one that is going to bring serenity. They think that he is the one that is going to be able to solve all of the problems that the world is facing and the chaos that is going on whenever the judgment began to fall, whenever the trumpets began to sound and all of these things begin to take place. They think that he'll be able to offer peace, that he'll be able to put an end and to stop everything that has been going on in the world up to this point. But we know that that's not his goal. We know by reading and studying Scripture that he is making false promises. He is basically tickling the ears of the people and telling them what they want to hear so that they will worship him, so that they will be more readily willing to do the things that the false prophet forces them to do. The false prophet himself will actually be able to perform some miracles that will then even more so entice the people to worship the Antichrist, because he will try to say that the power that he was able to do these miracles under came from the Antichrist. And we know that this is not the first time in Scripture where we've seen miracles performed that were mimicking miracles that God had already done. You see it in the Exodus, book of Exodus, whenever the Israelites are getting ready to come out of Egypt, and Moses has gone before Pharaoh, and we know that he would do a miracle, or Aaron would perform a miracle, and then some of the magicians and soothsayers and those of the Egyptian take there from Pharaoh, some of his employees, so to speak, would then in turn mimic those miracles. And we see some of that throughout Scripture. And you'll notice in verse 13 it says, "And the beast from the earth does great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men." And so he's going to call down fire from heaven. It will be broadcast. People will hear about it. People will see it. It will be well known that he'll call down this fire from heaven. And so people will think, well, if he is working for and representing the Antichrist, then the Antichrist must be who he says he is. He must be willing to do what he said he was going to do. This is the man that is going to save us. This is the man that is going to bring end to all this chaos. We will worship him. We will adore him. We will magnify him. And we've seen throughout history that there have been men who have demanded this worship. We know of men like Mao, and we know of men like Nero, and we know of men like Stalin and others who demanded worship, who wanted to be worshipped. He calls down fire from heaven. And then, here's the ultimate thing that will take place that will drive the people to take the mark of the beast and to worship the Antichrist and to listen and be deceived by the false prophet. It says, "And deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles, which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. We automatically begin to see here what is going to take place and what is going to happen. The Antichrist is going to be resurrected. He is going to step out of the casket. He is going to go and make his speech. There is going to be all these people who marvel at this and they wonder at this, and there is going to be no explanation on how that could have taken place and happened. And the false prophet is going to come in, and he is going to deceive with his tongue, and he is going to say, look at what this man has given the ability for me to do. I can call down fire from heaven. And he will also then cause the image of the beast to speak. They are going to create an image that is going to be in the temple. It is going to be defiling the temple. And they are going to expect people to pray to this image. They are going to expect men to bow down to this image. They are going to expect people to offer sacrifices to this image. It is a picture much like we see with Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and what they dealt with Nebuchadnezzar, and how he had the statue built, and when the music played, everybody was supposed to bow down and worship that statue. When all those instruments began to play, that's what they were supposed to do. And we know that all these other people, Jews and Gentiles, in that period that had been taken into captivity or were already a part of that kingdom, bow down and worship that image, except for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they had become trusted people in the court of Nebuchadnezzar. They had roles in his court. Somebody goes and tells on them, right? You automatically know how that goes. They went to the king. Now, them three Jews that you've been showing favoritism to, they didn't bow down and worship your statue like everybody else did. And so he calls them into private. He says, look here, guys. We're in private now. None of your other Jewish buddies will be able to see this. If you'll just, whenever the music plays, bow down and worship the image, I'll just kind of sweep this under the rug. We'll forget this ever happened and everything will be okay. What did Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego do? They told King Nebuchadnezzar, it doesn't matter how hot you heat that fiery furnace, if God wants to deliver us, he'll deliver us, but we will not bow down and worship your image. You see, what our world needs right now as Christians, what our world right now needs is for Christians and the church to have that same mindset, that we will not bow down and worship the gods of this world, but we will stand up for what we believe in, and we will live according to the Word of God, and we will be directed by the Holy Spirit as He guides us into all truth and reveals to us how He wants us to live and where He wants us to go, and shows us and gives us opportunities to share the gospel with the world. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were witnesses to not only the Jews there that had been taken into captivity, but to those that were already a part of Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom, of who their God was to them and who He still is. He delivered them from the fire, and not only did He deliver them from the fire, but He was walking around in the fire with them. He was already in the fire before they got there, and He was still in the fire whenever they got out, waiting for the next group that would come through the fire. Now, that's a whole other sermon. I could get into that, but I'd have to charge it for it. But it's amazing who our God is. It is amazing the miracles that He has performed and the things that He has done in our lives and the things that He provides for us on a daily basis, regardless of whether we're in the middle of the fire, regardless if we're in the storm, coming out of the storm, whether we're walking through the valley or we're up into the mountaintop. He is always with us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. He is the only one that is worthy of our praise. He is the only one that is worthy of our adoration. And He is the one that we are to be proclaiming to the world. He is the only one that can save. There is no political party that can save us. There is no amount of money that can save us. there is no other name written in Scripture and under heaven that can save us other than the name of Jesus. And the man Jesus walked on this earth, and he had a 3.5-year public ministry, and he equipped us as well as his disciples with everything that we need to live victoriously and to share the gospel with the world. But what we see with the false prophet, what we see with the Antichrist, is they're going to try to entice people to take the mark of the beast. They are going to try to force people, and they're going to be very deceptive with some people and in how they approach it. It is going to be much like we talked about earlier, the 10 nations are part of a revived Roman Empire, and the Antichrist could be seen much like Nero. And you want to know what happened in Nero's day? They expected every day for the people to take a pinch of a spice and offer it as a sacrifice to Nero. And they would tell the Christians, it's just a pinch. Nobody will notice. God won't care if you just give a pinch and offer that sacrifice to Nero. He won't see that. It won't make a difference. And that's the same thing that we're going to see here in these verses, is they're going to tell the people. The Antichrist and the false prophet are going to tell people, it's not going to matter. God's not going to care. God wouldn't punish you. God wouldn't send you to hell. What you have to understand is, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him can call upon his name and be saved. The people who go to hell choose to reject God. And they reject Christ, and they reject the means of salvation. And in so doing, they condemn themselves to hell. And what we see with these people who will take the mark of the beast and will bow down and worship the false prophet and the Antichrist are condemning themselves to hell. And why we have to be careful as Christians how we conduct ourselves and the message that we not only preach and teach, but how we conduct ourselves and live that message out in our lives can make the difference in whether someone surrenders their life to Christ or rejects Christ and condemns themselves to hell. It said there that he deceived them that dwell on the earth, verse 14, by the means of those miracles. And in verse 15 it says he had power to give life unto the image of the beast. Now we're not exactly sure exactly how this is going to take place. This could be something supernatural that takes place and the image of the beast begins to speak. It could be something that is done through computer programming. But however it takes place, it could be virtual reality, something or another like that. It could be that it's a broadcast on TV or on your smartphone or on your tablets. But the image will be speaking. He will speak where everybody can hear and understand him. And it will cause people to bow down and worship him. And those who will not bow down and worship him will be killed. They will be like the Christians in the day of Nero who were taken out and paraded in the arena and had the lions come in and slaughter them. Or Nero would take them and use them as human torches in his garden and all the different things that took place to Christians during that time period who refused to worship Nero. We'll see that for those that are left here on earth. We won't see this as Christians. We will already be in heaven. We know that from what we've been talking about. But for those who are alive during this time period, they're going to see this. They're going to experience this. If they aren't deceived anymore by the Antichrist and the false prophet and refuse to bow down and worship him, they will lose their lives. That leads us to verses 16 through 18 and the mark that they are forced to get. In verse 16, we see where it is applied. He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead. Now notice here that it's no longer going to matter your influence in the community, how much money you have, how much money you've donated to this university or to that cause or given to the Red Cross or volunteered with the homeless ministry or whatever it is that you've done. Everybody, if they want to be able to eat, if they want to be able to get a hotel, if they want to be able to trade in any way, if they want to be able to have a bank account, are going to have the mark. And notice, I had said earlier that the Antichrist can't come up with anything original. You notice where the followers of the Antichrist and the false prophet are going to have to receive their mark? In their right hand or in their forehead. Does that not sound familiar? Something we've already talked about? How the 144,000 Jews and those that are become believers because of the message of the two prophets and the 144,000 Jews would be marked by God as he is. Well, now Satan says, I kind of like that idea. We'll just use it my way. No man might buy or sell save he have the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. So here's what we need to understand as we kind of close this out. There are three ways to tell whether a miracle is of God or whether it's from Satan, as we talk about the two things previous to this, the image being able to speak and the false prophet being able to call down fire from heaven. Does the miracle worker confess that Jesus has come in the flesh? What you're going to notice is for the people that are left on earth during this time period, the false prophet is not going to say anything about Jesus. He is not going to do anything in the name of Jesus. It will all be in the name of the Antichrist. Does the miracle worker glorify Christ? That's what the Holy Spirit does. In John chapter 16, if you were to look in those verses about 13 and 14, you would notice that everything that the Holy Spirit does points people to Christ and glorifies Christ. When these miracles take place, the false prophet is going to glorify the Antichrist. Does the miracle worker say or do anything that clearly contradicts the teaching of God's word? That's what you'll see with the false prophet. The things that he says, the things that he does, will clearly contradict the teaching of God's word. And so here's how those that are believers will be able to know who the Antichrist is at the time that this begins to take place. Here's wisdom in verse 18. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. We already know what that number is, right? 666. We know that is an incomplete number. God is complete. If you were to look up his name in the Hebrew and the Greek and study all of it out, it would come to 888. Seven is the number of perfection, so he is above and beyond even that. But the number 666 falls short. The Antichrist can never measure up to Christ. He cannot save the world. He cannot give his life as a ransom for many. He cannot show the love that God showed to the world. He would not be willing to sacrifice himself for the world. The story was told of Donald Gray Barnhouse. 1 year, during the Christmas season, he was playing Silent Night on his piano. he purposely left off the end of the chorus. One of his kids, as he walked over to the stairs to see how they would react, stopped reading and picked up his harmonica and began to try to play the part that had been left off. Another kid was humming, trying to get the tune where they could sing the last part of what had been left off. And his wife hollered down the stairs and said, "Donald, did you do that on purpose?" It is a picture of how human nature demands the completion of the last note. And that number 666 shouldn't be something that we are so superstitious about or something that we are so worried and concerned with that we get bound down by it and bogged down by it. But that number should remind us that something is missing. And that something is someone, and his name is Jesus. Do you know Jesus? Have you surrendered all to him today? If not, you can do so before you leave this place. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you now.